Welcome to Off the Press, the program, where, of course, as always, we try to take a look at the headlines and make sense of it. This morning, with me to do so in the studio is Alesta Wilcox, who is a political analyst. It's good to have you this morning after a long time.
Nice having you, yes.
You abandoned us,
it's always
a pleasure to have you.
It's always a pleasure to be here.
We are happy to have you, even though you keep, you know, but anyways.
No, let's not say what we say backstage.
Okay, okay.
To the public.
Okay, okay, we'll leave it. All right, so we have four papers, four, I say, this morning to review. Shall we begin with the Punch newspaper, which would be displayed very soon. So the Punch says, uproar as Buhari makes fresh requests for $29.96 billion loan. That story is the big story for the Punch newspaper, and it's on page two. If by this time we are still borrowing and spending 80% of our budget on recurrent expenditure and overheads, it means we are not serious, according to NESG. And that's on the front page of the Punch newspaper. You find that story there. Fashola blames bad roads on abuses by users. And that story, as displayed, thank you very much, is on page 24 of the Punch newspaper. IPPIS, federal government can't frighten us with salary stoppage, says ASU. And that's on page two. And the federal government again deducts 35.51 billion naira from state allocations as bailouts on page 25. And the down part of the Punch newspaper, we have the sad story from yesterday. Seven die and scores injured in Lagos gas explosion. And that story is on pages 4 and 5 of the Punch newspaper. And customs blame DPR for illegal border petrol stations on page 42. And past government abandoned job-creating sector. That's according to the president on page 7. Activists present to Senate 2018 judgment against criminalizing speech, and that story again is on page 9. APC disowns suit seeking third term for Buhari on page 18, and 9-year-old girl allegedly commits suicide in Benue State on page 5. That's so sad. And then 8.8 million workers have pension accounts. That's according to PENCOM on page 28 of the Nation newspaper. And on the back page, we have Little Mercies Amidst the Turbulence. That's by Ayo Olukotun. Find out what that's about. And then FIFA ranking, Nigeria now world's 31st, still Africa's third. That's on the back page of the Nation newspaper, but the story is contained on page 45. Now let's come back to the front page now. Yes, you can see the picture story displayed from the gas explosion. I mentioned that is somewhere in Ajegunle in Lagos yesterday, where there was that explosion. Quite unfortunate, as seven people lose their life to that incident. Now, back to you, Mr. Wilcox. So which one do you want to begin? Oh, yeah. Somehow I missed out today, sorry. Card reader, PDP knocks INEC, seeks Yakubu's resignation. And that's on page 18. How could I have missed that? And then our infrastructure needs outweigh oil earnings, according to President Muhammadu Buhari on page 44. So the other story is contained on page 18. Yes, back to you.
Yes, I think the major headline, although we'll try and touch all the little ones, very interesting topics, headlines in the Punch today. The major opera, like talking about the opera, for me, I'm not, as an economist and a very, very conservative accountant, I don't believe in borrowing. I mean, I would take borrowing as a last option in terms of managing my, structuring my finance. But you come to a point where you ask, if you don't borrow, what is the option? This is a country we are against tax increases. We don't want the government to increase tax. We don't pay tax. We are both paying tax. We don't want government to raise revenue, because the only way government raises revenue is through taxation. And in our own climb, sale of crude oil, and then taxation, custom duties, well, call it every other thing, duties, everything is all part of taxation, levies, they're all. So that's the only way government raises money. And the tax net and the bracket is so low in Nigeria. It's even now that FIRS has, I mean, with all the innovations and that they had improved on collection, it's even now that even the custom, due to a lot of blockage of loopholes, that it has increased. So, and you have that of infrastructure. Now, one good thing about this government is they're not borrowing for recurrent expenditure, really and truly.
Okay.
Most of the borrowing is targeted borrowing to infrastructure development. But again, you must also watch what you are borrowing against your GDP and your capacity to pay back.
Because just so, yesterday, the IMF, I believe you saw that, was again warning Nigeria about our debt rising. And so you wonder, is this a good
I'll tell option? IMF to shove their take whatever paper or whatever the president shove into their nose. Who created this problem in the first place for Nigeria? Was it the same IMF?
Are you accusing them?
No, of course I am, because I'm not too young in this country to know all the time IMF has been pressing Nigeria to take loans, to do this, to diversify the economy, to do all kinds of pills that have. So IMF should just sit somewhere and shove whatever advice they have into their noses. Nigerians should grow their own homemade economic policies, and which is what we are doing now. I tell you, I don't have total details of this loan. I don't like loans, and I've said that clearly. But as a country,
and you don't think it's the best option? Also.
It's not. It is a necessary option.
Okay.
If those loans are for productive ventures, okay. If they're for productive ventures, for instance, we have lots and lots of infrastructural deficiencies that we need to address. So if those loans are for those building of our railroads, building of our highways, that you'll be told and you'll pay back and all. Well and good. Mm-hmm. But if it is for consumption, go and buy rice, import fuel, import this, which was the bane in the past, I think no. So we must be careful. So alternatively, so we should not take the IMF, we should not take a loan, then let us be ready to make the sacrifice of paying our taxes and having increases in taxes. Look at just VAT, 2.5% that everybody is up in arm. Meanwhile, Nigeria is the lowest has the lowest VAT rate in the whole world, you know. So we must make the painful options as to what do we really want. Let me talk briefly on talking fashion. About fashion, talking about the roads.
The bad roads.
Yes, I agree to a very large extent.
That
the abuse of our roads is part of the major problem. Because you look at it. Every year we talk about bad roads. A government comes, a government does its own bit, they leave. The next government comes, for instance, when Buhari came to power and everyone has in the world, the entire roads are bad. If the previous government has done something on the road, Buhari will not come and excavate it. It's just like Lagos now. If, as at the time, we all praise Fashola, let me take Lagos, we all praise Fashola. Oh, Fashola was working at the roadster. We all praise Ambode. Ambode was working at the roadster. Oshawole is just 6 months old in government. And we're all blaming Shomolu that, oh, the roads are bad, what's happening to Lagos? So if a road was properly constructed...
I think that's the thing, the
and
proper
properly used. No, listen, properly constructed and properly used. The abuses we have on our road is terrible. People will leave the main road and they drive on the median. They will burn tires on the road.
Because some parts are not good, really.
No. Even the way you use it. This is not the only country where the roads are not too smooth. If you go to neighboring countries, they are all like that. But the usage, the abuse. So Fashola has a point there. Not excusing the fact that this term of this are left life for too long. The resources were not there to keep them, to maintain them. And then even when the money comes in, it is half will be used for the road. More than half will be embezzled. And moreover, government officials, they want the road to get bad, so that every year there'll be budget to maintain, there'll be budget. So these are some of the things that we have. But I think some responsibility too is on the hands of the users that this is our road and we will use it responsibly. Talking about PDP and card reader.
Yes.
Shameful.
PDP knocks INEC.
Shameful for PDP. You see, each time PDP loses election, they now remember that there is what they call bad election. But when they use the same dirty system to win, I'm not for bad election. When it's the same dirty system to win, they don't complain. I can point, in the 2019 election, general election, what happened in River State? What happened in Akwa Ibom State? What happened in Delta State? These are the states where they use all the backhand tactics, the same manipulation, the same killing and everything to gain power.
So and you're dismissing it as political banter?
Political nonsense. They should be ashamed of themselves. It's only when they lose election they know that something goes wrong. Why did they condemn election in River State? Why did they condemn election in Akwa Ibom State, in Abia State, in Delta State? Why did they condemn it? Because they lost in Kogi.
But you can't dismiss it all.
I am dismissing it because it's coming from a wrong people. Look, if it comes from a neutral mind, people like us who have always protested from beginning. There are some public affairs analysts, commentators that always protested this, that has always talked about the shenanigans that happen in our elections. We have always talked about it. Mm-hmm. But they will claim glory, they will claim victory, they will claim. It's only where they lose. Only where they lose. Whenever they lose election, then there's hue and cry with their negative press collaborators. There'll be hue and cry. But anyway, PDP wins. No issue. In fact, everybody okay, quiet.
So you think it the call is, for Yakubu's resignation is quite uncalled?
Arrant nonsense. Total nonsense. So who would they put there? Was that Yakubu on the field that created all the violence that they created? Was it Yakubu? Was it Anek that created all the violence? Did Anek arm anybody? The two parties armed themselves. Let us be fair and honest. The two parties go to... Look, I keep saying, River State is my state. I say, what happens in River State during elections? Mm-hmm. To the point that a military officer in the March election, some military officers were killed in some places. Who armed them? Is there Anek? So each time there is a problem, they not blame my name. Meanwhile, you are the one that went to election with war. Mm. So we must redeem ourselves. We must redeem ourselves and respect the system. Then we all have a better platform. The thing with good equity must go with clean hands. PDP hands are soiled, dirty, bloody, so they can't come to equity. Anyway, they suffer loss. Let them take it that this is the architect of their own. Of their own making.
But again, you cannot dismiss everything completely to say they don't have a point.
They don't have a single point, my dear. I still stand by it. They don't have a single point.
We will move on, Mr. Wilcox. We will move on. So, which other story? Did you see the FG and the ASU?
Nice story. This is a story that Nigeria must win. It's not FG. This is one issue that Nigerians must win. Because
how do you mean?
Look, because ASU, I have always said it. Sorry to use the word, the gang of. Well, let me not use.
Don't use the word. For
NBC code.
Yes.
Yes.
So
yes.
Just go to your point.
I think ASU is showing themselves now that they are not responsible organization. That they have all along.
Remember, there are some factions of ASU that are for this.
That is why they
so you can't say it's the whole of...
Before now, mm-hmm. I'm saying the ASU as a whole. Because right now, all ASU shout on this, the government are not funding universities. But it does not contemplate in universities. Mm-hmm. The universities is one of the dirtiest places you have in this country in terms of corruption. It is the university system. And ASU is part and parcel of it. Every time you have a big goal, you put in money, you don't see what goes out, you don't see the result. Mm-hmm. Or you keep hearing the government is not funding the university. Now, what is wrong in government says, let us adopt this payroll structure. Nobody says your salary is not going to be paid.
Mm-hmm, but just
adopt this payroll system, which every other institution has embraced, even the military. Mm-hmm. And then you are now coming up with, you cannot follow, who are you? Are you the one that employed yourself? Are you the one that pay your salaries?
So you think this
is... You are now beginning to bring up some laws, universities autonomous, governing council is the one that employs you. So who appoints the governing council? Mm-hmm. Governing council employs you. So who appoints the governing council? It's just like saying that a landlord that has a house, it tells you how the house should be kept. Say no, it was a caretaker that put you in the house, not a landlord. Mm-hmm. That is arrant nonsense. So this is and it's not a fight for that government. It's a fight for Nigerians because this is a system. This they have been using this their internal mechanism to rip this country, to take unapproved allowances, to flix the country, and it's the country that is running that is losing. Mm-hmm. Not Muhammadu Buhari, not the candidate of the federation. It's the country that is losing. IPPIS has opened up a lot, have cleaned up our system to the point that there is a lot of savings.
Seriously, also
savings from ghost workers, from those who collect salary in three places, from everything. So it has cleaned it up. So why is that suit against it?
Some parts,
ASU should
some
part be. ASU should be not for what, that. Whatever faction. Those who have supported it, praise God for them. I salute their courage. Those who are kicking against it, they should tell Nigerians, let us leave this. University autonomy. It is governing council. Tell Nigerians what you are afraid of, mm-hmm. that should have exposed if you go through IPPS. And Nigerians should be on the side of the government, because on the side of themselves now. Mm-hmm. Because it is your money that is being stolen by these people. It is your no accountability in the university system. And there is more searchlight in the university system because lots of resources go in and nothing comes out. And what you get every day is blackmail against the government. Nigerian universities are not funded. They are not funded every day. Let us see, let this IIPS now expose the rot in the university in terms of their payroll structure. And Nigerians will be better for it.
Mm. Mr. Wilcox, like I see you're really, really passionate passionate
on this ASU matter.
Yes.
I will go anywhere.
So you believe that their argument is basically
baseless, baseless, criminal, and very, 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 very unbecoming of a citadel of high excellence. Mm. The university is the cream de la cream of a society. And when the university becomes this rotten and it's against what is progressive, then something is wrong with that society.
I agree with you that we'll be worried. We should be worried. Okay, so there's this story about the gas explosion yesterday, which was quite unfortunate.
One incident too many. Will anybody be held accountable? Will anybody go to jail for this? The answer is no.
But shall we learn, you know?
We have not. That's the problem. Nobody will go to jail for this. This cannot happen in the UK, and people and somebody does not pay the price.
Mm.
This cannot happen even in Ghana, and somebody does not pay the price. But this is Nigeria. Let us leave it for God.
No, we shouldn't get to that point where
where
it begins to look
that
like
that is
everything.
Where we have got into. Buildings collapse. How have you heard? You are pressed out. Have you heard that anybody was jailed for building collapse? What do you get? There will be carnage on the road. A truck will run through cars. Have you had anybody go to jail or hold accountable? Have we gotten to okay? How many do you take to investigate who owns the facility? Mm-hmm. Why was it not properly? Protected?
I mean, I hear you. We hope that questions.
So for me, it's one is there too many. Unfortunately, mm-hmm. Let us keep like we say, let's leave it for God, and that's what we always do. No, and then before we leave for God, people keep committing crime against this.
Let's be a better nation. Let's be a better nation. So we'll move on to the Vanguard newspaper. With me here is the very passionate Wilcox this morning. So let's continue with this passion to the Vanguard newspaper. And it says, Buhari presents rejected 2016 and 2018 $30 billion external borrowing plan request to Senate. Yeah, you recall that it was rejected by the 8th Assembly. But now it's back again on the floor. And 100 billion Naira constituency project, ICPC, ActionAid, NOA, now in charge. And that story is on page 8, that's a national orientation agency. And IPPIS reps wading to FG and ASU face-off. And that's on page 9. And again, 6 die, 23 injured, unfortunately, in Lagos gas explosion. And gunmen killed 2 chiefs in FCT, 3 others in Taraba. That story, as displayed there, is on page 6 of the Vanguard newspaper. Editors and can others rally against hate speech bill. Nigeria Editors Conference had a meeting around that, I believe. We are against bid to curtail press freedom, says Guild of Editors. How to Save the Media by Adefaye Ogunleye, and defamation laws inadequate to tackle hate speech, says sponsor Senator Abdullahi. And Dangote, Elumelu, and Otudeko, 22 others, bag National Productivity Award, I beg your pardon. And that picture story is on pages 5 and 14. Of the Vanguard newspaper. Nigeria's pension assets hits 9.58 trillion naira. That story is on page 16. You can see it at the top bottom left there. And we will be tough on sex for Mark lecturers, according to Governor Abiodun. And that story is on page 11. And I think that's about what we have on the Vanguard newspaper. Behind it is just sports news. So which one do you want to talk about?
Well, the hate bill that keep generating controversy.
Mm-hmm.
How did we get to this level?
Good question.
Good. So, I mean, nobody has sat down before and said we needed a hate speech bill because something happened. Something went wrong. I think from 2015, the issue of hate and falsehood become very pronounced in our society.
Mm.
So, look, that election that brought Muhammadu Buhari, the pain it caused in the hearts of so many people that's the continuity today is what gave rise to this. You have all kinds of nonsense, all kinds of talk. Somebody will sit in his bedroom and conjure things and make it real. And then the moment it goes to the social media or even sometimes even the conventional press will carry such things.
Mm.
So that is why we get to this level. So if editors,
but that
if
does can, not justify.
No, I'm coming. Okay. If can and others had call for caution when this started, we won't get to this level. But for me, we need a bill. But what we should be talking about now is some of the penalties and the conditions.
But, you know, again,
yes, we need to address this issue.
I agree with you that we need to address the issue.
Exactly.
But again, you know that the focus is, you know, the penalty.
So that is where, I mean, I cannot, the death penalty that was bringing that, and I think maybe that's what was causing all this Buhari. But that would not need a law that would regulate
conduct.
But
there are aspects of our constitution that's taking care of those.
No,
The question is not taking care of everything. You are just worried about the fake news.
You can. You know, every day is that evolve. Mm. So you can always bring things to in line with realities. We need a bill. Mm. We need something that will check people. That will check people's mentality.
But not gag them.
Nobody's gagging anybody.
That's the argument.
No, it is not gagging anybody. It's
that's
only
the
saying
argument in some
you
parts.
Must be responsible in what you are saying. Is it gagging you that you wake up one day and say, "My mother wants to marry a wife," and print a video on card and spread all over the newspaper, okay, and even press officers are carrying it? Is that part of your fundamental human rights? That's fake news.
So I think it's to check.
Yes, is that part of your human rights?
There must be fact checking. There must be accurate news.
Good.
Yes, that's what you're saying.
You must be critic of government. I am a good critic of government.
Mm-hmm.
But I've never abused anybody. I've never carried a news that even something that I'm not clear about, I will not come and see it on air.
No, we won't want you to carry fake news.
So why will I do that?
Let's move on.
Because I'm responsible.
Paper. Okay.
So I'm supposed to be responsible.
All right, Mr. Wilcox. We'll move to the next paper, which is about the last one we'll take in the interest of time, and that's this day. Buhari seeks fresh National Assembly's nod to borrow $29.96 billion. We've talked about that. We're not going back. Yeah. So grab a copy of this day newspaper. That story is on the front page, but it's continued on page 10. Pension asset hits 9.58 trillion as PENCOM targets 90 million workers. That story is on page 5. I'm presenting a sailor's autobiography. Find out what that's about. And Dambuwal wants against dictatorship. That story is on the front page also, but it's continued on page 10 of the This Day newspaper. And the big story is federal government places $200 million bank guarantee with UK court in P&ID role. Prosecution opposes Britain's request for bill variation. That is it on the front page. And then the Police Service Commission and police move to mend fences on page 8. Are you happy about that? And
they said a rough fight.
Is that how you say it?
Yeah, that's how I see it. Okay. I don't understand why a regulator and an operator should be. But let's talk about this pension asset. Just
very quickly. You have like a minute.
Yes, the pension asset. I think whether we are just 8 million already only captured, God, that is too low. That means a lot of people are still in breach of that law.
Mm.
A lot of companies, because we have over 80 million workers in this country, as far as from the National Statistics Bureau of Statistics.
Mm-hmm.
So if we have cover only 8 million, then it is terribly low and something urgent needs to be done so that more people are brought into the pension scheme. Because you can't be cheating your workers.
Mm.
An employer cannot be cheating your workers. So it is the right of your workers to have a functional pension scheme.
Mm-hmm.
And this is very, very, this is easier, cheaper for everybody. And so if just 8 million in how many years now? I think it's too low.
Mm-hmm. Because workers have the right to know where the remittances go and be sure that it's going somewhere. It's deducted.
The pension commission is one of the most regulated commissions, and it's one of the most efficient and effective commission we have.
Mm-hmm.
We are talking about 9 trillion in assets.
That's
and,
a lot.
And still growing.
Mm-hmm.
And still growing. I'm happy that I have a good pension.
Okay, so we're going to end it on that note.
And I hope you have a good pension.
Yes, I do have
a good pension. If not, I will take this place.
I do have a good pension. I'm happy to say that. Okay, so thank you so very much, Mr. Wilcox, for coming.
It's always my pleasure. When you are passionate about the country, time flies.
That's good. Thank you for being passionate. And this is where we are going to end it on Off the Press. We will continue this next week from Monday to Friday, 8:30 here on Plus TV Africa. And I am Amaka Okoye. Have yourselves a good day.
Yeah.